people are that are coming in, let's let them get seated. Okay, this afternoon's brief meeting is primarily about some new things that are going to show up in the student handbook next fall concerning grading practices. The faculty and myself have been working quite diligently over this school year to come up with some grading practices that will be more consistent. A few years ago, we went to a common grading percentiles in each class, the 60, 70, 80, 90. Okay? Teachers still have the ability within the gradebook to determine the weighting on different things, and we're going to continue to allow some of that flexibility with each teacher. Okay? One of the things you might have noticed this year is that extra credit is pretty much gone. Any extra credit for this year is content-based. It's not taking a grade sheet home. It's not getting 5 points for putting a cover on a book or anything like that. We want to make sure that you are graded off of the things that you're supposed to know and be able to exhibit that you've got the content in each course, okay? So that's kind of the purpose. So these things will take effect next fall. I've kind of discussed the rationale. One of the things I also did is I put together some definitions, which, you know, I don't know how much question you as a student might have on those, but sometimes as we're talking to other adults, questions arise, so I wanted to come up with some definitions. The first thing is a guiding principle. Those are things for us as adults in the building. These are things that we are stating that we will do, okay, in order to make our grading consistent for kids. You've been dealing with rubrics probably for quite a while. It's probably something in the high school you might be seeing more of. Than especially the upperclassmen than at other times. That's something we're going to continue to work on and develop rubrics so that we are giving a kind of a roadmap for you to success on given assessments or given assignments in class. Okay. We also want to and are beginning to collect exhibits of strong student work. And again, the intent of having something like that, so as a student, you can take a look at something, get an idea of what somebody else did that met a high degree of success in that class or for that assignment. Okay? Formative assessments. Formative assessments are things that we are going to use and should be using right now. As simple as a teacher questioning students, Milt, explain this. If he's able to explain it, I know that he's got it. If he's not able to explain it, maybe not. Could be as broad as having the whole class go ahead and answer one problem, choose the right answer. Maybe you have to show your work for that problem. But as a teacher, I can take a quick look how many in the class got that problem right. Those who got it wrong, I can look at their student work to see whether what part of it they didn't get. So some of it might be technology-based. Some of it could be in the form of a quiz, okay? Again, the quiz could be a graded quiz, but it also might be something that a teacher takes a look at to determine, okay, how's my class doing? How's this class doing in terms of the content? If they find that the class has got it, that allows them to ramp up their teaching or continue on. If they find that a class overall, we're not doing so well, we can reteach and try and improve, okay? Or I can identify specific kids. If there are certain students who are struggling, now I can help them directly. Okay, so that formative assessments are only formative if they do something to direct teaching. Okay, so they have to direct the instruction. Summative assessments. My best description of this right now for you, those are chapter tests. Those might be a unit test. Those might be you have to give a presentation. Summatives are always things that are graded. Okay, they're going to work towards your final grade. Summative grade, that's what you're going to earn for the trimester. Okay. Final exam. Final exams are the exams at the end. Everybody in here is going, well, we know what final exams are. Okay. Final exams are still going to be 10% of your grade. Okay, so that hasn't changed. What is the Iowa Core? That's from the Department of Education. The Iowa Core is what we are supposed to teach you. Basically, they're being direct to us and saying, these are the things that students should be able to know and do. These are the things that prepare them for college. These are the things that prepare them for anything post-secondary, to go into the workforce. All right? So that's kind of our guiding light. As educators, these are the things that we want to provide for you. Not every kid in here is the same. So we want to make sure we're starting to differentiate more and more so that we are meeting your learning style. That doesn't mean you work less. That doesn't mean that you learn less. It means we attempt to meet you where you learn best. Okay? Your progress is gauged towards the Iowa Core because those are the things that they're going to teach. We want to make sure that you have multiple data points that come to your final grade. And what an example of that might be, okay, Mr. Anderson's history class, before we take the final test, we're going to do a presentation, or we're going to do a group project, or we're going to do whatever that might be. So you have to do that. Maybe he had you, you've covered sections one and two of a chapter. You've answered the questions at the end. You may have even had lecture notes about that. Now he says we're going to have a quiz. Okay? That could go towards a data point. We want to make available to students the opportunity to redo or retake assessments. Okay? There will be a time frame for this. Fellas, are you with me over there? Please be courteous. Redos or retakes. We want to make sure that you have those opportunities. Okay, it doesn't mean you get to redo or retake something 9 times. Okay? At the most, you're going to get one opportunity to redo, retake. That opportunity has to come in within 2 weeks of that assessment. That opportunity isn't given to you just because you say, hey, Mr. Blissmer, I want to retake that geometry test. Okay? That opportunity is given to you when you've earned it. So what Mr. Blissmer might take a look at is, one, did I do my homework, my practice? Have I done those things in his class? Have I done maybe a review coming up to the summative? If I haven't done those things, what do you think he's going to make you do before you do that? You're going to do that drill and practice, that daily work. You're going to do that review stuff. When you've shown that you can do that, then here. Absolutely. Absolutely. We've talked about the rubrics and the work, examples of work. One of the reasons we want to become consistent is, honestly, if I give you something back that says a grade of 78 on it, you're going, well, that's above C+. But what does that really tell you? Does that tell you how to improve? Does it tell you what you did well? Okay, so one of our goals is to increase our communication with you as a student. Now, that can be challenging for teachers, but that's something that's important, is for us to give you feedback that is really relevant and helps you improve in your learning. We also want to provide that on the report cards, or midterms especially. So if you look at your midterm that will come in the mail, at midterm I always ask the faculty, please put comments on there. Let the student know. Right now we're very canned in our comments, okay? We go to the drop-down box, we find the one that best fits for you, we put it in there. I'd like us to be more descriptive in our feedback. That doesn't mean midterms have to change necessarily. But it might be that on my things that I get back to you, I give you better feedback there. Or I might just sit down and talk with you for 3 minutes on how you did. What did you do well? Where's an area of growth? Be more specific. Be more specific. We also want to improve that communication with parents. giving your mom and dad good feedback on how you're doing. Our late work practice. Okay, again, I said we want to be consistent. Right now, depending on the class you're in, if you don't have something done on a given day, maybe you lose 10%. Maybe the next time you turn it in, the best I can get is a 50. Okay? Probably not a great deal of motivation for any one of you in here to do something you can only turn in and get a 50. You're all smart. Is 50 passing? No, it's not. So what's your motivation? We want you to know that, okay, we understand you're busy kids. You're very busy. But when you leave this place, does the world still have deadlines? Will your job still have deadlines? Yeah. But there are sometimes things that come up in life that you have to be able to organize your time to have things done. So in our late work policy, up until that summative chapter test, unit test, that type of thing, you will be able to turn in those things that will go towards your summative grade up till that point of that test. Okay? This week, prime week, a lot of activities going on. Kids are track team, you know, I think you each have a couple nights of it. This gives you the opportunity to say, okay, last night got home 11:30 from Clarion. All right, it was late. I'm exhausted. I still got chemistry to do. I'm supposed to have it done tomorrow. It's going to take me, you know, whatever amount of time, and then I'm supposed to get up and go to lifting the next day. As a student, then, you'll have that opportunity to decide, okay, I'm going to do it. I know I can still get full credit for it. Maybe I won't do it tonight. I'll do it when my mind is fresh, when I'm ready to learn. Okay? So we're trying to take some of those things into practice. What you won't find to be graded are the drill and practice. The first time you get something, I'm going to pick on Mr. Anderson again and just say that, okay, he asked you to read that section and do the questions at the end of the section. All right? That's the first time you've read that chapter. It's the first time you've attempted to answer any type of question like that. That's not necessarily a graded exercise. Going back to Mr. Blissmer's geometry classroom, he gives you 20 problems to work in geometry. You're supposed to have them done the next day. Okay? It's the first time you've worked those types of geometry problems. That's not a graded exercise. That's an opportunity for you to practice and get better. All right? But if you decide not to do those things, take the final or the summative test and don't do so well, do you think you're going to have to do those? Yeah. So does it make sense to do it when he's asking you to do it, or when any teacher's asking you to have something done? Yes. Teachers will still give you deadlines or dates. This is due this day. That's to help you to stay organized. We certainly don't want you trying to get a chapter's worth of assignments done overnight. That's not beneficial to you. That's not the intent of drill and practice. You want to build on those skills. The redo retake policy. Okay, right? First one, you're responsible for doing the work prior to that time, including the non-graded assignments. So that tells you you're going to have to do it one way or another, and you should do it because it's to your benefit. It's not punishment. The things we ask you to do, even though sometimes you think they're punishment, that's never the intent. We want to build your skills. You get the one opportunity to redo or retake or revise, because not all assessments have to be a regular test. It could be a paper that's due. If you choose to retake or to revise, you don't get to take the higher score. The second score you take is the one that goes in the grade book. Okay, we've kind of talked about number four, where you have to produce the evidence that you've done something. Let's say you're a student who's done all of the homework, you've done everything that's asked of you, but you're still struggling with something and you want to redo or retake it. That's where a teacher might give you some additional work in the area that you're weak. That helps them to be specific to you. What are you not getting? Here's an opportunity to sit down with your teacher. Please note the bold sentence there. Teacher gets the final say. We talked about the 2 week. This is going to work, I think, really well in the fall. It's going to work really well for the most part in the spring. In the wintertime, I don't know how it's going to work. We start getting, you know, 2 snow days in 1 week, and you know, so we're going to have to be flexible as a faculty. You have to work with us as students on that. The plan is for next year during the school year, during study hall, each teacher each week should have 1 study hall period where they don't have their normal study hall section. You guys will go to one of the colleagues and that they have right near them. That'll be their opportunity to work with small groups of kids to reteach or to give redos or retakes. Okay, so that's, we're trying to plan that in the school day as much as we can. Because if I had you raise your hands about how many of you are involved in activities, about 85% of you would raise your hand, and it's hard to get you outside the school day. Okay? So we're trying to make that work for you as kids. Final exams, we don't redo or retake those. Rationale, you've already had drill and practice. The final exams are cumulative across the trimester. So there are already things you've done. We also have that thing in high school that's called eligibility. We have to get that out. So there are some things that have to take place. Okay, teachers will schedule those dates and times for redo retakes. They'll try to have a set time. So if you have an Algebra 2 test, this is when Algebra 2 redos or retakes will take place. If you're looking at reteaching, come in and see Mr. Meyer here. If that's not possible, then you have to make arrangements with him. Faculty, what did I miss that I scrolled through maybe too quickly? Students, I'll even entertain a question or two if you have one. Yes?
So homework's not graded?
No, well, that's not necessarily true. Drill and practice, first learning. First attempts at something are not graded. Okay, it doesn't mean that homework is not graded, but if this, again, I go back to that algebra, I'll use algebra this time. If Mrs. Picard gives you a set of problems that we worked on the board today, first time you've seen them, okay, and she says, do these 10 problems, have them done tomorrow, that's your practice. That's your time to build skill, not necessarily graded. Most of our faculty have said, we're going to track that though. We're going to track which ones you have done, okay? Because when it comes time to redo retake, they want to know what you've done and have not done, all right? But if you're somebody, I've got this, that's not a problem for me, I guess that's, you know, you get to choose a little bit. My encouragement to you, or my advice to you, is do your homework, because you're going to be better off. Any other questions that you might have? Anybody have high anxiety over something that we said? Again, this is an attempt to be consistent across teachers, across grade levels, to help you as students. Okay. When the bell rings, you're dismissed. Thanks for your attention. I appreciate it.